Jetzt wirklich. Like that? Ah, I see. Yeah. Let me first thank to the organizer for organizers for inviting me. Now it's okay. So I will give. I apologize that I will give dissident talk, which is not exactly in the topic of the conference, because it is about integrable systems and not about disorder, but it seems something completely different, but maybe it's not so different, because it is important. I mean, models with disorder and integral models are not so different, because it depends on what are you measuring. For example, matrix models can be used to study disorder phenomena, even if they are completely integrable systems. So I will speak about the first. I will spell out the title. This thermodynamic Wetteransatz, and this is quantum field theory. and this talk is based on work made with Didina Serban and our students Long Vu, and some unpublished work. So let me start with. Too many buttons. Let me start with some motivation. So the thermodynamical Wetteransatz was invented long ago in the late 60s to compute the free energy of systems at finite temperature, integrable systems which satisfy this Young-Baxter relations, about which I will say one word later. Here it's sufficient to say that integrable system means a system with as many conservation laws as the degrees of freedom. And this is why we can go to variables, action angle variables, and solve it completely. The Young-Young technology of solving the system at finite temperature were used by Alexei Zamolochikov, the same who computed the correlation functions in Liouville theory, to find the finite volume energy of the system, which is something horribly complicated, because at finite volume the vacuum is filled with virtual particles. But he used a very simple trick to take the for Lorentz invariant theory, to take the thermal partition function and to look at it from the other side. So the compact time became a finite volume. Lately, in the last 10 years, people started to think about applying Wetteransatz-related methods to computing to the computation of correlation functions and more subtle quantities. for this purpose, it would be nice to have more subtle statistical, mechanical, or field theoretical formulation of Betelnzatz, not just thermodynamical one. And people started to ask this question, if the thermodynamic Betelnzatz is some Euclidean field theory or statistical theory, long ago, at least 15 years ago. So I will mention just some several works by Kato and Vadati 15 years ago. They formulated in a bit cryptic terms, but exact, they formulated the exact cluster expansion for the TBA. Then Voyanorovic computed the Gaussian fluctuations around the thermodynamical states, the fluctuations of the densities. And he found that that the data, the computation, contradicts to the known data. So this this contradiction was lifted by Posguy in 2010, when he pointed out that first the computation of Voyanorovich was correct, but he missed something. He missed the effects of the measure. So Posguy added the term from the measure, and it and got the right result for periodic and open boundary conditions. in particular, he demonstrated why there is no 1/volume corrections to the free energy, and the first corrections are exponential in the volume, exponentially small. The reason for that is that the Gaussian fluctuations from the around the thermodynamical vacuum and the measure cancel completely each other. So then, lastly, with Didier Serban and Long Vu, we rediscovered the cluster expansion of Kato and Vadati. We didn't know about this paper, their papers before. So we obtained a graph expansion for the free energy of the thermal ensemble in terms of tree and loop graphs, which remember quite a bit Feynman diagrams for some field theory. And the aim of my talk today is to formulate this field theory, which generates this these Feynman graphs. So this will be the QFT for the thermodynamical Betelnzatz. So I will start with some words about what is factorized scattering. So if we have integrable theory, we have an S matrix, so all the particles are described by plane waves, and they scatter in such a way that by pairs. So first the two of them, then the second and third, and the first and third. And there are some consistency conditions for this scattering. For example, the scattering can occur in different order, and the result is the same. And these conditions are called Young-Baxter equations, which were actually, Baxter wrote them for vertex models, but they were interpreted in terms of scattering by the brother Zamolotchikov in 76. So they computed from the unitarity and Clausius symmetry and the Young-Baxter equations, they computed the two-particle S matrix for the ON model and then for other solvable models. So the properties we will need here, first let me mention that this variable U will be omnipresent in my, this is the rapidity of the excitations. So if we have a massive excitation with energy and momentum related in this way, we can parameterize this relation by P is equal to sine and E is equal to cosine of some rapidity variable. So we it is more advantageous to use this variable because it has a nice analytical properties. So we will use the unitarity condition for the S matrix and also the property that if you have particles with the same momentum, their S matrix is equal to minus one. This means that when the two momenta coincide, the particles behave as fermions. And we will see later that this fermionic picture will pop up later for the free energy. So let me say what is first the usual, the standard Betansatz. The Betansatz means that any state in an integrable system can be written as superposition of plane waves. So n particle states, the n particle wave function is a sum of products of one particle wave functions, which are simple plane waves. So the particles in such a state can scatter between themselves, the theory can be or cannot be Lorentz invariant. Here I will use I will not assume that the theory is Lorentz invariant, but that there is a mirror transformation from the physical to the mirror theory, which exchanges space and times and time. So we have a Euclidean theory with space and time. Then you make a double weak rotation, and the Minkowski the space becomes Euclidean time and the time Euclidean space, and similarly for the energy and the momentum. So the trick of Alyosha Zamolochikov, this photo is made about the same time he wrote his first paper about the TBA, was to consider the mirror theory. And actually, just the opposite. You are interested in physical theory at finite volume R, then you apply this mirror transformation, and you consider instead of the mirror theory in infinite volume, but at finite temperature. Of course, if you compute in infinite volume, you will obtain infinity. Yes, for any for the free energy and anything, because this is why you need to confine the volume in some large box with the length R, with the length L. So this is the picture. You have a physical theory with a large time evolution L, which becomes a mirror theory with in large volume, but defined at radius R. The aim is to compute the partition function, which is trace of exponent of this Hamiltonian, which we don't know what is it means in the physical theory, or the trace in the mirror direction of the mirror Hamiltonian, which we know how it acts because it's in the infinite space. So if you take a mirror particle that wraps the time circle, what is the effect of this wrapping? It's just a Boltzmann factor, exponent of minus the energy of the particle times the time r. If you take physical particle that goes in the physical direction, it's the physical circle, so you assume that we have simplest boundary conditions, periodic in both sense. So actually this is a torus, and you have a periodicity here in this and in this direction. So if you have both processes, then you will have also S matrix, because they will scatter with each other. If you have many particles, then you have product of many S matrices. So this the process of having many particles in both directions can be described by a Gaussian field, by two Gaussian fields, one of them related to the mirror particles, which gives the phase of a mirror particle which goes around the thermal circle, and the other one which gives the phase of the physical particle that goes around the space circle. In order to obtain these scattering matrices when the particle cross, you introduce a two-point function of this field, which is the logarithm of the scattering matrix. This is just the scattering phase. So you have a Gaussian field or free field with expectation value, which is equal for the phi field, just r to times the energy, and for the phi bar field, l times p. And also they interact with this simple correlator, logarithm of the S matrix. So these fields will be the ingredients of the field theory for the thermodynamic Bettensatz. So here I wrote the partition function as expectation value, partition function of several mirror and several physical wrapping operators as an expectation value of a product of these exponential fields, exponent of minus phi, exponent of I phi bar. And if you evaluate it, this is just the product of all possible S matrices between them and these Boltzmann factors. So up to now, everything seems completely trivial. So if we are at finite volume, we have to put some consistency conditions on the momenta and the energies of the particles. So the conditions come from the periodicity. So we assume that this is a torus. You have periodicity in both directions. Therefore, if we twist the torus before reconnecting it, then nothing will change. This means that if we have a mirror particle which makes one spatial circle and then continues its time circle, the result will be the same as if it didn't make this term. Up to a trivial exponential factor. So this process can be simulated in the following way. We have one mirror particle and one physical particle, and take the rapidity of the physical particle in such a way that it's exactly the same as that of the mirror particle up to a mirror transformation. We know that the scattering matrix is equal to minus one for coinciding rapidities. From here, we obtain this consistency condition, which is a quantization condition for the phase. The total phase must be always integer times 2 pi. Similarly, for the wrapping particles in the physical direction, they can make an extra tour, and you have a condition for them. So these conditions are called Beta-Young equations. So it's as simple as that. Now our aim is to put many as possible mirror particles, I mean, some over all possible mirror particles that wrap the mirror circle, because we have we construct the torus in such a way. We take the cylinder, then we cut it, we put all possible mirror particles on this cut, and this means that if we sum over them, this means that this is we insert the identity operator. So this means gluing. Also, we glue in the other direction, and this operation means that we have to sum over all possible intermediate states here. So we know how to describe the states that are compatible with the periodicity condition. They are characterized by integers. So the phases are these integers. And each phase is a function of the rapidities of the state. So we don't know the periodicity condition makes this phase a complicated function of the rapidities, but the energy is always sum over energies of the individual particles. So we have the partition function. We have such an expression, infinite series with these mode numbers, which should be all different as for free fermions, and these Boltzmann factors. So, yes. This one, this is completely general formula. You don't need the exact expression. This works for any form of the energy. No, I don't want to specify. This is just a general combinatorial argument. Yes. No. Mass. It's more complicated because the factorized scattering. For massive particles, it is well defined. For massless particles, the potential is large only with massive particles. Yes, this is the S matrix. Yes. It is the partition function of Psi Gordon. Yes. Yeah. Yes. Yes. But yes. This? Why?
Because it's protocol, like protocol R matrix is defined as matrix is defined by matrix, right? It's protocol for matrix and matrix is defined.
Well, you are speaking about the XXZ model. This is the spin chain version of the. Of course, you can you can construct the Sine-Gordon model from the XXZ. Yes. 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 So you assume that you have a vacuum. So this vacuum can be the ferromagnetic vacuum or anti-ferromagnetic vacuum, which is filled with particles. But this is your vacuum state. And upon this vacuum, you have excitations. So you sum over all possible excitations around it. Not exactly. Yes. Not exactly, because here you assume that that the theory is a Lorentz invariant, or at least that there is a, and for if you have a chain, then it's. No, there if you take a spin chain, if you take a vertex model, then you make the transformation, and. Your rapidities will become these inhomogeneities. Of course, if you take a model with a lot of inhomogeneities, yes, then you will have this. Yes, you can. But I, this is not the situation I'm considering. You will not have in this model. You will not have a Lorentz invariance. It's not. No. No. It's. Sine-Gordon, in any case, Sine-Gordon is not among the models I consider now. To consider Sine-Gordon. We need to also to take into account all possible bound states, yes, and kings. So you have to. It's more complicated, but the same machinery works. But you have to work more to. But I will give at the end. I will give an example, which is the Sine-Gordon model, and there everything works. So where was I? Here. So the main trick when you try to sum up this series is that in the limit of large L is to replace these sums as by integrals. But the problem is with this condition, that all the mod numbers should be different. So you have to relax somehow this condition. And there is a well-known trick which works as follows. You sum over unrestricted mod numbers here, but you subtract term which correspond to n1 equal to n2. And the particles here, they have twice more energy. And it's on. So what you do is you add particles which are multi-wrapping. They wrap not only once, but twice, three times, etc. And then you can relax this condition and obtain a sum over non-restricted particles, but with you have to sum over all possible wrapping numbers from 1 to infinity. So this is very similar to the exponentiation of the partition function of free fermions, where if the written as in this form originally, then you can by this trick exponentiate, you obtain the one fermionic loop in the free energy, but with a factor of minus one. And this minus one is here. Now the next non-trivial step is to go from phases, or from replace the mod numbers by phases is trivial. You just divide by 2 pi, and you replace the sum by an integral. But if you go to rapidities, you will have a Jacobian, and this Jacobian is something which is this is it's given by the celebrated Godin determinant, which is the Godin matrix is the matrix of the derivatives of the phases, here the main trick in my talk is to represent the Godin determinant in terms of these bosonic fields I introduced before, wrapping fields. So this term is quite obvious. So this is just the phase of the operator, of the phase of the particle, which goes in the physical direction, and so here you just replace the derivative of the phase by the derivative of the operator. So the operator takes care of all the S matrices on the way. But the problem is that the phase depends, the phase phi I depends not only the ith of the ith rapidity, but of the all the other rapidity. So we have to differentiate with respect to them also. So this thing is not taken care by this operator. So you have to introduce fermions in order to complete determinant. So this is the statement. You introduce fermions with the same propagator, log of the S matrix. I will not give the proof. You just can expand this expectation value and compute the average by weak contractions, and the result will be the Godin determinant. So once you know that, then you sum over you integrate over all possible rapidities. The integral exponentiates immediately, and you obtain this this nice representation of the partition function of the expectation value with these rules of this action. So sum over wrapping numbers give this logarithm. So you have a kind of deformed Liouville potential times the derivative of psi, and you have a Gaussian term with psi, but also multiplied by a factor depending on the field phi. Here, and also also in the dispersion relation. This works for any dispersion relation. So the simplest square minus p is equal to n squared, but you can put anything. This is a non-polynomial potential, so you can you have a Feynman rules which have infinitely many vertices if you expand this logarithm. You have both. You have phi bar bosons. Huh? Sorry? Oh, because let me return to the Godin determinant. So in order to represent the Godin determinant in terms of operators, you need to introduce this phi, this psi. This form the measure. I mean, this is the thing that Voinovich missed. Hmm? No, you cannot. The inverse of determinant, yes. No, right. No, you can't. This is the standard representation of a matrix. If this were numbers, then the matrix of 1 minus something is just the standard formula. So now, if we expand this action, we will obtain these Feynman rules, where you have here, you have psi bar and psi, no, phi bar and phi. You have psi bar, psi and phi. And also you have the expectation value of phi bar. This is the red circle, and phi. You have two propagators, which are logarithms of the S matrix, the bosonic one and the fermionic one. So the diagrams you will have are trees made only by bosons. Also, you have trees with one loop, because you cannot make more than one loop. This is the way that you cannot. So it's one loop exact in this sense. And also you have the same diagrams, but with one fermionic loop. And it happens that these two cancel, and you obtain only the trees. And the tree graphs satisfy a nonlinear equation, which is exactly the TBA equation. Let me now explain what is the meaning of these clusters. The point of the cluster means wrapping particles. So we have one main master wrapping particle, and it is dressed by other particles in this way. So it interacts with many of them, but you can represent this cluster by a single particle, but with renormalized energy. This is the so-called pseudo-energy. So now I want to explain in terms of path integral why there is no loops, and derive the TBA equation just as the equation for the critical point of this section. So I write a classical action with which is the previous one, but also I introduce two extra pairs of fields, rho bar, sigma c, and theta bar, which generate the propagators. This is the how we call it, Hubbard-Stratonovich transformation. Here I can look for the expectation for the critical points of this action, and the critical points I just have to differentiate. So one of the equations is this one, with rho given by this derivative of the logarithm, and if I exclude rho from here, I obtain a nonlinear integral equation for the expectation value of the field phi. So this TBA integral equation. Okay, derivative of the log of the scattering matrix. I thought I wrote it somewhere. This is the so-called dressing kernel. So this DDU log of S of UV. Because you contain the derivatives in the action, so the here you will have the. Now I have to explain why there is quantum corrections. Of course, it's almost trivial to see that this is because we have bosons and fermions, and there are such a, the action is such a, that we have a supersymmetry. So let me show the supersymmetry. You have this supersymmetry generator, which you can express the action as some other action, which is fermionic, Grassmannian, acted on by this. Okay. So, by a well-known localization, such kind of theories are localized on the critical points of the action. The critical point is where QB is equal to zero, and this is exactly the TBA equation. So, well, this is the standard. I will not explain this, but yes. So now, no, it's different localization. It's no, not at all. Dr. Matt Heckman, exactly. Yes. We skip that. This is the same argument, but with physical particles in the physical states. Then I have to finish, but I wanted to explain also the case of open boundary conditions, where instead of wrapping, we have a cylinder with two boundary conditions, and the physical particles, instead of going around the boundary to the other, scatter from it and come back here. So we can follow the same argument and obtain, so these are the TBA, the beta equations, and then you can obtain the same, exactly the same action. The only difference is that the propagator will be product S matrices because you have scattering back and forth. And the second argument is with minus sign. So the consequences of that are dramatic because there will be no more cancellation of the determinants because you will have two scattering kernels. So instead of previous partition function, you will have this one. The theory is still one loop exact, but there is a O1 subleading term. And this is exactly the so-called boundary entropy of the system, which can be found by taking the ratio of the open and closed partition function, and this is the expression for it, which was by Doré, Doré and collaborators in 2010. And then reconsidered by Posguy. So finally, I'm finishing 1 minute. Finally, to take some concrete model, so the Sine-Gordon model, which is the Liouville with mass, Liouville with two terms. And you have the same, I don't use gamma, I use beta, B. So you have S matrix, which is of this form, And well, I apologize, but I like very much this shift operator. So I can write the matrix in terms of this shift operator acting to a very simple kernel. It's called universal kernel, which is one of our cosh. And this kernel is the green function for d plus d minus 1. So using that, I can write the same field theory for the Singe-Gourdon model with this form of the action. And now I can using this form of the universal, this property of the universal kernel, I can get rid of it by multiplying by changing the variables by d plus d minus 1. If I do that, I will have something very, very nice, no kernels, but only difference operators. So this is one-dimensional theory where without well, we have one derivatives here, but we have finite differences here. And if I take the critical point of this action, I will obtain this this equation, which is the discretely real equation, yes, and this is the so-called from here we can derive the so-called Y for the Singe-Gourdon model, which is equivalent to the so-called Q system, and I don't have time to explain to dwell more on this, but this is this Q system is in general they call it quantum spectral curve, and this allows to find the complete spectrum of the integrable theory. So I'm finished. Thank you. A very good question. Indeed, actually, we started to